everything is going my way. Riding clean, living dreams. Just let the barber and I'm feeling like Midas. Heard him say, give him praise. What's in the water got you acting like this? Ain't a day gone by that I don't try to thank the Lord up above. And if you wonder why I'm loving life, I'm close and I tell you what's up. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, playing cards, laughing hard, barbecuing, waking up the whole block. Music loud.
Welcome to the Greater Joy eCampus Virtual Summer Playlist Series, featuring tonight Pastor J. Russell Harris and Bishop Shelton Daniel as they discuss ministry and transition of Greater Joy. Like, share, and hit the heart button as we tune in now to this special interview. Enjoy. Well, hello, everybody. Welcome to the virtual playlist here at Greater Joy Church. Last week, we had an amazing experience with Dr. Janae Avent, Pastor Stephanie Battle, and our very own campus pastor, Pastor Kim, as they talked and they reflected about the transition with ministry, as they discussed some tea, as some of you like. And it was an amazing experience. But without further ado, I have our very own leader, our founder of everything, the Joyland Community Network, Greater Joy Church, Bishop Shelton Daniel here with us today.
Man, it is good to be here. And Elder Harris, you know, thanks for all you're doing to explore and to catalog all that we're doing. Because when you look at what is happening, it is unprecedented. It is not a map or some template that says how this is supposed to happen, especially when you're talking about the Baptist Church.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so when you talk about all of these things that are going on with transition, amazing that it is happening. But thank you so much for capturing it all.
Yes,
so
sir.
We'll have this, you know, for years to
yes,
come.
Sir. So we're here. I want you to hit the share button. Go ahead and hit the hearts. Hit the like. Share this with as many people as possible. Let's spread the news that we are on the air tonight. I know we are on summer sabbatical, but I asked Bishop if he could let me borrow a couple weeks to do our summer virtual playlist. Last week, it was featured around Tupac, Keeping Your Head Up. And I asked Bishop, I said, who's your favorite R&B artist? And he said, Charlie Wilson. So at the end of this interview, you're going to hear some Charlie Wilson. So like I said last week, brace yourself, saints. Brace yourself. So let's dive right in, Bishop. Let's talk about the transition. Let's talk about the infant stages of the transition. How did this come about?
Well, several years ago, if I can just be transparent, I got to a moment that I was just overwhelmed and tired. Mm-hmm. And I didn't understand all that was happening as I'm not physically, but I was mentally and spiritually depleted. Mm-hmm. And so in that time, I stepped away from the church. You know, mm-hmm. folks say it all kinds of reasons why I stepped mm-hmm. away from the church, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. you know, whatever they don't know, they'll mm-hmm. make up.
Yeah, yeah.
But what I really stepped away from is because I got tired.
I was
actually depleted. Mm-hmm. And so I sat down with Daddy, mm-hmm. and then I sat down with my family, mm-hmm. and I went home. I remember, you know, going home and talking to First Lady. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I still get teary-eyed behind it mm-hmm. because at that moment, only thing First Lady said was, what do we need to do that you going to be okay? Mm-hmm. And it was, I said, I'm just going to step back, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. for a few weeks. I'm going to step back for a month. And I think I ended up stepping back for about 2 months mm-hmm. And kind of staying away from the church. When I say the church, I went to church every Sunday. Mm-hmm. I just mm-hmm. didn't go to Greater Joy, right. and I didn't go to do the work. Mm-hmm. The whole staff, you guys handled all mm-hmm. of that. Mm-hmm. And it was in that time that the Lord was just showing me that it was time to make sure that we had plans for the future.
Right, right.
And he reminded me that this wasn't my bride. Mm-hmm. This belonged to God. And so when I looked at all of that, I began the processing in my mind that I needed to do something different. When you create from the ground up, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. when you then out of that plant other churches, Harris, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. it's every time you do it, it, mm-hmm. it takes a piece of it.
Takes a piece of it.
Yeah. And so this was my joy in doing church and doing ministry, but I knew that if it was going to continue, it was going to need more hands. Mm-hmm. So in that time away, God talked to me and shared with me that we needed to do. And it was at that moment that I began to say, okay, who do I put where mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. in these locations mm-hmm. to offer that assistance? Okay. And so, you know, that's when I began to reach out to Pastor Kim. I already had Pastor Artez in the wings mm-hmm. for the future as anyway.
Right, right.
So reaching out to Pastor Kim was the other piece for the hub location.
Right, right.
So that's how it all started. Mm-hmm. It started with sometimes the struggles of life mm-hmm, mm-hmm. can help you or catapult you into, you know, mm-hmm. where you need to go.
Right. Right, right.
I didn't know it, but the trouble got me there.
Got you there.
Yeah, wow. Yeah.
Trouble got you. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about, because I'll never forget, while we was out during COVID, we had our big meeting, the big meeting. Mm-hmm. And that's when the announcement was made that Pastor Kim would now be the campus pastor. Tell us about how you felt that day before the announcement and how the announcement came about.
Well, it's still bittersweet. Mm-hmm. You know, anyone who says it's not is lying. Right. You know, she's my baby sister. Pastor Artez is my long-term confidant. Mm. Pastor Latasha is a baby that's growing up in our ministry. Mm-hmm. And so when you talk about my love for them, that's one thing. But also, I love the church.
Right.
And so as I transition, it is sweet because I know it's right, and it's sweet because I know that if we don't make a plan, we diminish and kill the church. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And we'll talk about that in a minute mm-hmm. about folks staying in place too long, mm-hmm. you know, but ultimately I still struggle with saying it's time to go to it. It's like this, JR. Mm-hmm. I remember, I love to play basketball,
right,
and I remember playing basketball. Mm-hmm. One of my last times I played full court basketball with folks, I was playing with some young boys and I, you know, I'm thinking I'm still able. And I'm going down the floor, and this young boy passed me the ball. JR, I could see it coming. Uh-huh. I could see the ball coming, but I couldn't respond. Mm. That ball hit me right in my face. You know, the game is so fast. Right. I could see. I love basketball.
That's a good analogy.
You see, I could see it coming, but I couldn't respond.
Right.
I immediately, hold up, somebody sub me. Get me out. Get me out. Get me out. And it was at that moment that I realized that I wasn't able to do what I was doing before. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, I was preaching 4 times a Sunday.
Yeah, yeah.
2 times on Tuesday and mm-hmm. Wednesday. And that's not funerals. That's not meetings. That's not revivals. Mm-hmm. That's not other mm-hmm. services. Mm-hmm. I knew even though even though I'm going to miss some things, I know that Pastor Kim, Pastor Artez, and Pastor Latasha are the right things at this. So how do I feel? I'm teary-eyed because no one likes to get to the point in old where they can't do like they used to do.
Right.
But if you want, or if you have the love for church like I do, you want it to go on.
Right.
And so I have a bittersweet feeling.
Right. So let's talk about, I remember you preaching four times a Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
But let's talk about the valley experience for you. Like, were there any moments of the valley experiences in your 30 years of preaching? Have you ever had any low moments that you would really want to encourage a young man like myself? We talk all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But to those that's watching us today, tell us about what was that low moment like for you?
Well, the low moments of ministry for me have been the failures of my ministry, the stuff that I could have done differently, things that I did wrong, and things that that I could have made better decisions on. You know, when you talk about how you build ministry, and then the failures of your life, they're not mistakes in our lives. And not only about the mistakes, but that we're perfect. And if I were to tell you about moments where I want to, I can't particularly name something that catastrophic in ministry, but I can tell you that people expect you to be, not inhuman, that you're not human.
And I never forget one of the things you told me before I did my initial sermon. You said, boy, you live in a glass house now.
Yeah.
And that thing has always stuck with me.
That's terrible. That's terrible that you have to live like that because that's what people expect us to be. But you got a wife, you got kids.
Right.
You got outside things that you do. And sometimes in life, we don't get all that stuff right.
Right.
With family. I'll tell you one of the things. For instance, my daughter. I should have been at every basketball game. I was teaching Bible study or doing something different that and if I had to rewind, I wouldn't have cared if it was a Sunday morning service.
You would have been there.
I would have been where my daughter was. Now, I spent a lot of time with Taylor and her sporting and being with my children and my family, but it's more that I should have done.
Right.
That is what I'm saying. And if I were to tell you about a young man, what you don't make the mistake of putting anything when it comes to church before family. It's God and it's and then it's family and then it's church. So if I tell you moments that I wish I could do over, I haven't had any catastrophic moments.
Right.
I mean, just where, you know, life was, you know, just blew me out of the water.
Yeah.
But I made mistakes and I did things wrong and I should have done them differently.
Yeah.
And I wish that I could rewind to some of those moments. So if I were to pass that on to you, man, I'd just say, make sure you take time for you.
Yeah.
That's you know, good. This past week, Pastor Artez is on vacation, right? And he said, I'll be back Sunday. And we said, no, you're not going to be back Sunday. JR's going to preach.
Yeah.
You know, and he said to me this week, he said, Bishop, thank you, because what we going to need from you is making us do that stuff.
That's
what Pastor Artez said, make us not make the same mistakes. Right. So when he goes on vacation and PK goes on vacation, Natasha goes on vacation, I'm going to go there and preach so we can have stable ministry, but those guys can take a break. Because if you do nothing else when you start pastoring, make sure that you take a break.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Good. Take a break. That's a word for a lot of the preachers that may be listening to us. Make sure you take time for your family. And you hear it from our very own leader, Bishop Daniel, you know, just take time for yourself. And I can definitely appreciate that, because even, you know, having appointments on Sunday mornings, being on vacation the week of, you it's like Artez, what he said yesterday in Rona Rapids. Sometimes you don't want to take time to study. You just want to enjoy your family. That's all you want to do.
But if you're pastoring, come Wednesday or Thursday, you got to stop and prepare, because no man can stand and proclaim God's word unless he's prepared. You know, so what we have to do is don't put you in that position. So when you start pastoring, you calling me, say, Bishop, look, I need to go on vacation this week. Can you, and I'll come and fill in for you. And and then it becomes all of these things that cause us catastrophe because we don't take time with family. And we don't spend time mentally with ourselves. You know, and so it's those things that I would just recommend.
And you have, I will say this, it's always to have a good friend. Good to have a good friend that you can talk to. And that we see that with you and Pastor Galliard. That he's one. Tell us about that relationship.
Man, me and Pastor G, man, that's a long story, but he's the guy who, for me, who I can have those conversations. We can talk. You know, I can't even tell y'all some of the stuff we talk about. It's raw, it's regular, and it's raw. And I think Pastor Stephanie and Pastor Kim was talking about the tea last week. That's the tea for me and G.
That's what I was trying to get to, the tea.
The tea of me and G is it's just straight. It's just regular. We don't have to in any way have any conversations about, hey, man, I need to tell you something, and it's confidential. And no, it's none of that.
We just talk.
We just talk straight.
That's good.
And he brings that relief for me that reminds me that two of the major ministries in our cities or in our region have pastors that are human. And that's the thing that I like about with Pastor G. It goes back, man, you know, where we became these great friends was, and I won't share, he's going to be with us on one of these interviews, and I'll let him share that. But there was a question that was going on, and I just asked him. And he said to me, out of all the people in the city, nobody has just come and asked me. They just assumed stuff about me. And it was from there, we're talking 15 years ago now, that from there we just have established this relationship. And to your point, yes, you need a confidant like that. You need that person you can talk about anything. Whether it's family, you know, anything goes on with our families, goes on with our spouses, me and G can talk to each other about those things.
You know, I look at me and Bishop Antoine Brown as how you and G relationship is.
And you got to have that.
And
Bishop Antoine's a good person for you to have that relationship with. And he's it's got to be somebody who's normal.
He keeps me level.
You need that normalcy.
Right.
What you find is we try to portray this person that is impossible to be.
So
I would just, you're my son in ministry. So if I were just to speak into your life, don't even start that. Don't even start trying to be somebody you're not. You are James Harris.
You're only one.
That's all. That's all you are. You aren't pastor and that's a title that's been put upon you by man, but that's not who you are. And don't allow what you do to be who you are.
That's
not who you are. So be who you are and then do what you do. But don't get them convoluted and confused. That, you know, you start trying to be pompous and pious based on who people call you. Lady called me yesterday. She was talking to me and she's like, hey, Reverend. I meant Bishop. I meant Pat. I said, my mama called Michelle. See what I'm saying? So when you get down to that, that preserves and that preserves relationships with people. So me and Galliard, we don't call each other reverend or pastor or, or bishop unless we're in the presence of parishioners or where we need to or are supposed to do that. But when it's just me and him, it's James and Shelton.
James and Shelton.
Yeah. You got to have that kind of person.
So that's good. And so I want to shift back to where we are right now in the transition. And I want to talk about how do you feel now with where we are with the stages? How do you feel about this transition right now?
Well, we are in a good place.
That's good.
We are over the hurdle of the shock of it all for the people. And now they are starting to settle in to ministry. Remembering that anytime there is transition, there is loss. And in that transition, some aren't lost. They are just still trying to figure out is this going to work for them?
Right.
You see? And so we're in a good place as we deal with this. We are working with the whole fact. And I'm hoping that viewers will understand this. We are working with a transition that takes a long, long time. So we're talking something started 3 years ago. Now we've moved from the virtual to now we are at 2 times a month. Well, we got other folks preaching. So PK and I are preaching alternate Sundays. Pastor Artez and I are preaching alternate Sundays. And Pastor Latasha and PK are preaching alternate Sundays. So the transition is working. When I say we're in a good place, I see the dust settling, real ministry happening. The pastors are taking their rightful places and starting to implement ministry that was or ministry that we never had that should be.
That should be.
So they're getting now to exercise their own ideals and ideas in ministry. And so we're at a place where now the next step will be even in September will go further. So they will see more of them and less of me. So what when we look at it, JR, yes, it's going great. Remember there's another factor here. Let me just throw this in.
Okay.
You guys are having to do ministry. We're having to do ministry. We're transitioning. Not only are we transitioning, but we're doing it at a time that has never been seen in history.
Yeah, that's true.
When you're dealing with pandemic, there hasn't been a pandemic in 100 years plus.
Right.
So we're doing ministry like we've never done before. So PK and Pastor Artez and Pastor Latasha and yourself and others are having to do ministry at a time that has never been seen.
Yeah.
So when you're talking about Pastor Kim, Pastor Artez, and Pastor Latasha transitioning, that's one thing. But transitioning in pandemic.
Yeah, that's
that's another whole situation. Yeah. And they have handled it. They have handled it well.
Right. That's good.
Yeah.
That's good.
So we're in a good place. Come September, we're going to I'll ease back even more. And I'll take us here because this is the next part of it. After the end of the year, they will not just be campus pastors. They'll be the senior pastors next year at these locations. And I will move into the position in which I think the calling on my life is at this moment, which is the bishopric. Right. So what I'll do is I'll be, rather than pastoring the people, I'll pastor pastors.
Tell us. That was leading to my next question.
Right.
When you, I wouldn't say retire, but when you enter into that role of bishopric. For those that don't know what the role of a bishop really is, can you expound upon that and tell us, okay, this is what Bishop Shelton Daniels doing day to day?
So what really happening is we have multiple locations, and we're going to put the pastors there, and they will do what I've done for the past 30 years. Mm-hmm. And then I will be there to help each pastor, training each pastor, mentoring each pastor. Mm-hmm. And then another part of this that people don't gather is, a lot of times, JR, all they think we do mm-hmm. is the Sunday morning preaching.
Yeah. Yeah.
And mm-hmm. hey, I understand, because yeah. that's what they need, that's mm-hmm. what they come for, right. that's what they know.
Right.
But when you deal with what we have done mm-hmm. community-wise, yeah. city-wise, right. working to be that liaison between mm-hmm. The city and the church and those parts that we try to mm-hmm. fuse together, right. I'll be helped, because even though they jump into pastoralship, mm-hmm. they still won't have all the connections of doing like, what needs to be done
yeah, yeah.
between church and city.
Right, right.
And so the city depends on the church to make sure that we can help with all of the things that mm-hmm. are the nuances of what we face day to day.
Yeah.
And so day to day, I'll be so my main role as the bishop would be to pastor pastors, mm. and I'll be there to assist and do whatever they can't do, mm-hmm. and when you say can't do, is they can't do that moment or this ties them up. Mm-hmm. What mm-hmm. happened in the past was I had no hands for that.
Right. Right.
Now we have that position. Yeah. This position will put God putting me into this position will allow me to help in those areas.
Yeah. A lot of people probably have never known what the role of a bishop is. They just think it's another title.
Yeah, but, it's not just a graduate title up to that position.
Right.
The bishop is supposed to be oversee
yeah.
multiple things.
Right.
And what confuses folks really is mm-hmm. because we have used the title bishop as a graduation place rather than the person who's the bishop doing the job, doing the work of a bishop. Right.
Yeah.
Right. So it's not just the parishioners confused on their mm-hmm. own. We mm-hmm. confuse them with the way we do things.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. So good. That I think that what you're going to find is we'll have a healthier mm-hmm. Kingdom. Mm-hmm. We'll have a healthier kingdom as a result of what we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you'll also find that we'll have healthier preachers.
Yeah. Yeah, that's good.
We'll have healthier preachers.
That's good.
Yeah, because you being my son, mm-hmm. Reverend Gore just got put in position.
Congratulations, yeah, Reverend Gore. Y'all shout out Reverend Gore.
Reverend Gore is going to pastor this church. And mm-hmm. so you, Reverend Gore, Pastor Kim, mm-hmm. Pastor Artez, Pastor Latasha, will have some to say, hey, Bishop, can you come and do blah 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 blah?
Yeah.
I need a break from this, and you know that it's going to be solid
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
because of what you guys have come through and under.
Definitely, mm-hmm. definitely. So again, shout out to Reverend Gore.
Yeah, Rev, my guy.
He's going home.
He's going home, and I'll get the information out, because we're gonna celebrate him. We're going to go down and celebrate with him when that transition actually happens.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, shout out to Reverend Gore. He is one of the pure hearts of ministry, and God has saw fit to give him that location. Yeah. And I'm glad about
yeah.
that.
Yeah. So listen, if you have not already shared this live, please do so. We're here at our summer virtual playlist talking with Bishop Daniel about the transition. So last week, Pastor Stephanie and Janae, they talked with Kim, and a lot of people really got to see Pastor Kim, you know, how sweet of a person she is. They really got to see Kim for, you know, who she really is,
right.
you know. So let's talk about the Rocky Mount location.
Let's talk about it.
So how do you feel about Pastor Kim? Because she is, look, she came up, she said something last week about Project Reconciliation that they're about to do. And that's something I'm going to take with me. I like that. So mm-hmm. she's coming up with amazing ideas and projects to get the ball rolling with this transition. Tell me about her. You tell me about your relationship with her and how you feel about this Rocky Mount location.
Well, Rocky Mount location is the hub of it all.
Right. Headquarters.
It is the headquarters. It's where we began it all.
Right.
Another week or so, we're going to have conversation with Pastor Artez and talk about the Roanoke Rapids location. We'll talk about Butner too. Yeah. But if I were to, first of all, let me say, Rocky Mount has been an amazing city to pastor in.
Yeah, yeah.
I have enjoyed working not only with the community in which we sit, but I've enjoyed, you know, working with the city, the officials of the city, all that we could do to be a part of that.
Yeah.
It was not something that myself and Pastor Kim planned.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
PK and I, when we planted her in Butner, it was, she came under our leadership. She's been with us all our life because she was under Daddy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And when she transitioned out of the Durham into what God is doing with her today, she came under Greater Joy, Rocky Mount, and then we planted her in Butner. And she's done an amazing job with that church there in the rural area.
Mm-hmm.
PK is, she's different.
Mm-hmm.
She's very high strung. Mm-hmm. You know, she's on 1,000 most of the time, you know. And, you know, the love that I have for her as a pastor is nowhere near the love I have for her as being my sister.
Mm-hmm.
It just so happens that the Lord has allotted us
the
opportunity to share together.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing, JR, because look, I had a chance to do it with my daddy.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I have now a chance to do it with my sister.
Mm-hmm.
And it's amazing to see it happening and to see how she evolves.
Mm-hmm.
What's different is I'm laid back.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing excites me.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing gets me. I'm not going to be on 10,000.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be in an uproar.
She will be
talking sometime, and she'll be like, really? Mm-hmm. You know, as though I didn't hear what she said.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just not that person that's going to be on 10,000. So our styles of approach are different, but our foundational structure around how we do ministry is the same because we came from Daddy, and Daddy believed that people were first.
Okay.
He believed that community was important.
Right.
He believed that no matter what people did, you gave them a second chance.
Mm-hmm.
And
when
restoration is birth, it is my baby.
Yeah.
But it comes from Daddy.
Yeah.
Because that's how he thought. He thought that it didn't matter if you were full of drugs, and it didn't matter if you were an alcoholic. It didn't matter if you had a mistake in your life or something had fallen apart.
Yeah.
Daddy believed that the church was supposed to be a place to help those folk.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so I believed that that's where restoration was born. And Pastor Kim believes that. She believes that people are people, and you'll find out that she's not going to throw folks away unless they just don't want to be a part.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's just who she is.
So I feel Dr. Avent Harris' spirit, and I'm sure she's listening and she's watching, just to get into a little tea.
Uh-huh.
Have you guys, you and y'all brother and sister, so have you had any type of disagreements yet when it comes to anything ministry?
Well, we've had our differences and differences.
And how do y'all handle that as well?
We don't, there's no way you cannot not have disagreements.
Yeah.
There's just no way you cannot, see, when God creates two different people, they have two different thought patterns and ways of approaching stuff and approaching ministry. So absolutely, we disagree on the way we do things or the approach to it. But what she and I don't have is the same thing me and G don't have. We're not gonna have fallouts that are going to divide us.
Right.
That's gonna divide
me. That's good.
Because see, think about it. Think about it.
what different, me and you gonna differ, but falling out does what?
Yeah, it does nothing.
It absolutely does nothing. So Pastor Gellion and I made a pact years ago that the things that we disagree on, we're gonna disagree on them, but we are gonna disagree on them behind the closed doors. And when we come out, the public is not going to see James Gellion and Shelton Daniel divided.
At odds, yeah.
And what happens with that is so when we disagree, we just put that to the side. We work on something else.
That's
that
good.
Particular thing we can't come That's to grips
good.
On, so we work on something else.
That's good.
PK and I, listen, she been my baby sister. She been dependent on me. Listen, when I was in the street, I looked after that little girl.
Yeah.
So when you look at today, man, we got a bond that nothing gonna break us apart. Nothing. We might differ in how we gonna do new members or how we gonna do men's ministry or women's ministry. We might have a different approach, JR, but that's okay. And it's not going to be something that we're going to fall out about.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it doesn't make sense.
Right.
Think about it.
Right.
It just does make sense. So when I look at what I do in ministry, I just say, if she got a different approach, I say okay. And let me tell you why I say okay, JR. Because I said to Pastor Kim and Pastor Artez, that they were going to be the leaders for those locations. And if I'm going to say they going to be the leaders, even when they do it differently than I think they should do it, I got to let them lead.
And you still support them.
Got to support
them. Still support them.
So who says is wrong because I don't agree?
Right.
It just means I would have done it differently.
That also says you're able to adapt.
Well, adapt and understand.
And
understand that I ain't always right. Understand that if we're going to the future.
Right.
See, I'm going to all, listen, some young folk don't even know who Charlie Wilson is.
Right.
His music is absolutely amazing.
But
there are some newer musics. If that's a word,
yeah.
If I'm saying that right, but doesn't make it bad. It just doesn't make it my cup of tea.
Your cup of tea, right?
So when it comes to when we look to move forward in ministry, man, if you're gonna lead in this new generation, we gotta find ways to say, okay, we're gonna allow them, to move it and do it their way.
And you've done extremely well with understanding our time, our generation, unlike other pastors. And you mentioned something earlier about pastors that don't know how to transition out.
Yeah.
That's been in the seat 50 and 60 years.
It's hard for them, man.
Yeah.
It's hard.
Yeah.
And I understand it. It's hard for them. I'm not condemning them.
Right.
Because it's hard.
Right.
When you've been that guy forever,
and
the time comes and it's time to transition, even though it's time, it's hard.
It's hard.
And that's why they stay too long, because it's hard. There are many other factors, there are many other factors.
Yeah, of course,
Haven't planned to do anything else.
Yeah.
Economically, it's tough for them.
Yeah.
You know, all that stuff is factors. Yeah, but at the end of the day, we have to have the spirit of legacy and the spirit of future.
Yeah.
And the generation behind us and knowing that. See, I would rather make a mistake in appointments than to make the mistake of staying too long. See, we can fix appointments. Let's say Pastor Kim ends up, and she and I have had this conversation, so this is not me throwing any shade at Pastor Kim.
Right.
Let's say she doesn't work out for Rocky Mountain. We're going to make adjustments. But let's say I didn't start this transitional period and I got sick.
Right.
Or I had some catastrophe and died, then there's no plan for the future. Now we've left sheep finding a shepherd. And y'all know my stance on that. I don't believe that sheep can find shepherds. That's a problem. That's a problem. So they stay too long, JR. They stay too long. And
the key word you said was future, though.
Yeah.
I think they deal on, they dwell on their legacy and don't think about future.
They dwell on right now. They dwell on, they like it.
Yeah.
It is intoxicating if you let it be.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's good. That's good. Yeah.
Yeah. That height of preaching and the glory of God falling in the house and taking over the entire service.
It is
intoxicating for anyone.
Yeah, it is.
And they won't admit it, right? But it is intoxicating.
That's good.
But at the end of the day, you cannot always look at that preaching moment or that height of ministry moment as the future of the church. For me, I'm more concerned with the future of the church, that the church continues. Be foolish to do all your work and then go down in the drain.
Yeah, that's good.
Behind you killing it.
Right. Right.
See, got me? Yeah. Not behind the people killing it, but behind you killing it. Because you, in a few years, your son, AJ, I'm not going to be able to reach him.
Yeah.
I'm gonna be 70 years old in 10 years. Yeah. So how would I can't reach somebody who's 8 or 9 years old?
Yeah, I see.
And draw them into ministry. We're not talking about the preached word. The preached word can be done, but the reaching of
the
people.
The connections.
After a while, you're not able to adapt into that.
Yeah.
So you have to make some concessions. Look, my dad is 80 years old. My dad is still a good preacher.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Dad is still a good preacher.
I enjoyed him. Yeah. He came a couple years ago for your anniversary.
Yeah, he's still a good preacher. But he'll tell you it's still a stretch for him to reach somebody who's 10 years old.
And he's a straight shooter, too.
Yeah. And all of that doesn't mesh. He can still preach the gospel.
Yeah. Yeah,
but pastoring and leading the church took some different. Those are different things.
Different things.
Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah,
this has been a good conversation. So I just wanna let's talk about. It seemed like you never hear much about this church, and that's great. Joy Butner, tell us where they are in this entire transition as well.
Man, the reason you don't hear a lot about them because they're out in a rural area, but they are doing great work.
Good deal.
Man, Pastor Kim and who was the founder of that church, and now Pastor Latasha, man, they are doing great work. Just yesterday, I was watching them with they were doing their vacation Bible school and reaching tons of kids. And see, every church doesn't have to be on the radar. For it to be doing great work, you see it, and you can, if you follow Greater Joy Butner, you'll find them gospel preaching, great teaching, and great outreach in community. And Pastor Latasha's working to keep that moving forward.
That's good.
So shout they do the same her. Stuff that we do.
She's an amazing, sweet individual.
Yeah, she is
real cool. I'll never forget, I met her at a meeting a couple of months ago we had in Durham, and we connected real.
She's scared to death.
Yeah.
filling shoes of Pastor Kim. She's scared to death, and she's doing the work, and she's working to reach the people in the community, and that's all we can ask.
Yeah.
But kudos to Butner.
Yeah.
They are family oriented and doing. One of the things that I can say really that's a great impact to people out there. They're doing a community Bible study thing, and it's really engaging. And I'm really, really proud of my brother, who's not a preacher, who does that out there.
Brother Rodney.
Yeah, Rodney. Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. He does a great job with that. And that's a big piece of that ministry. So they have huge amounts of their congregation that's in the Sunday school. So whereas in usually it's 10%, no, mm-hmm. their congregation may not be huge, but a huge amount of their congregation is in their fine family Bible study.
Okay. Well, that's good. Yeah, it's really that's good. Stuff. Shout out to Pastor Natasha Hicks. She is a sweet lady. And we look for to see you all here on September the 3rd and the 4th.
Yeah.
Here in the Rocky Mount area for our annual homecoming. Are you excited about homecoming?
I'm excited about everybody coming together.
Yeah.
And it'll be one of those, it'll be momentous occasion for me, mm-hmm. Because I'll be preaching with all three locations together, and it'll be in the final years of my day-to-day pastorship, so I'm excited about that with Pastor Kim and Pastor Artez and Pastor Latasha, all of them together, and you and Reverend Gore and all of my family just being around for that occasion. I'm real excited about us coming together.
So one of the things that we was able to do was just make registration absolutely free.
Yeah.
So all you have to do now is just go to our website and just purchase your shirts. We're going to wear the shirts on that Saturday, September the 4th. The event will start at 11 a.m. We're going to kick off with something totally amazing. I've already connected with the officials of Rocky Mount. And I'm going to make this announcement here. We are going to honor Bishop Daniel on that morning at 11 a.m. So listen, you need to be there early, bright and early, as we honor Bishop Daniel, as we rename Boone Street Park to Daniel Park. That's going to be an amazing experience. That's going to be amazing. How you feel about that?
I'm glad about it. It's been much joy for us. We've enjoyed that space over there, and the community has enjoyed it. So we just want to have safe space. I remember the reason that we purchased that park was, I went through the community early on in the ministry, and kids were playing ball in the street and things of that sort, and it was dangerous. Mm-hmm, so we revamped that park and redid that park.
You just put a walking trail out
walking
there as well.
Amazing walking trail. I go out there myself and walk. Uh-huh. And the walking trail is there, the softball field is there, and the basketball courts was major there. We're planning to put some space out there for soccer and things like that. So kids that are interested in that can do that.
That's good. So September 3rd and 4th, I want you to make plans to be in the city of Rocky Mount. Yes, it's Labor Day weekend, but listen, you're already here in Rocky Mount. You're going to make plans to come. Listen, just take
They're going
to
cook out anyway.
They're going to cook out anyway.
We got us cook out for
listen,
you.
Listen, so come. It's just a few hours from 11 to 12. And if you're a vendor, if you're a business, you want to come out, listen, go to our website, www.greaterjoymbc.org. Fill out the form to become a vendor on that day. Listen, purchase your T-shirts on that day. It's going to be an amazing experience. We're going to have gospel and Southern Soul on that day.
Okay.
Gospel and Southern Soul. And yes, it's going to be clean Southern Soul. Y'all listen to it anyway on Saturday mornings when you're cleaning up at the house. So y'all be there, be ready. Let's enjoy this whole entire weekend. So we're going to bring this to an end. But it's been a pleasure talking to you as always.
Thank you as always.
We've had so many conversations in your pastoral office, and this has been an amazing journey. I told my wife the other day when we walked into now Pastor Kim's office, I had to go out.
Yeah,
because it was a moment. Right? Yeah, I wasn't ready for that. It took a toll on me, and there's a little game that the ladies did on the last live. It's called a word association. You just say one word. I say the name. You just say one word. So I just want you. I'm gonna shoot some names out, and you tell me about your first thoughts in one word about this person. Pastor Kim.
Amazing.
Pastor Artez.
So when I talk about Pastor Artez, I would say he is taking this opportunity, mm-hmm. and he's massaging it and working it, and mm-hmm. it is doing some amazing things and turning. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Is turning in some different ways. Mm-hmm, he's spending mm-hmm. a lot of time with young people, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. a lot of time with youth ministries and things of that sort. Mm-hmm. And out of that, we're going to see the birth of more church.
That's good.
Yeah.
That's good. Your son.
Let me do Pastor Latasha first, and then I'll come back to my son. Pastor Latasha is approaching ministry as a young new pastor should, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Being afraid of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Being cautious, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. but doing some great, great work with. Mm-hmm. Stepping into shoes. See, when you're transitioning from Pastor Kim to Pastor Latasha, you have personalities that are opposite of the spectrum. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Very outgoing, mm-hmm. very, very talkative, and mm-hmm, and, mm-hmm. and Pastor Latasha is laid back, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and yeah. not as talkative.
Yeah, yeah, I can remember.
But she's approaching it
yeah.
the way she should and mm-hmm. pushing herself. I'll mm-hmm. say that. Mm-hmm. She's pushing herself mm-hmm. out mm-hmm. of her comfort zone.
Yeah.
And she's yeah. working to get the work done.
Yeah. There. Latasha, I mean, Latasha, she I keep talking about it. She made a good impression on me at that meeting. Like, she is real humble. Like, real, yeah. real cool.
That's a good one word for her.
Yeah, humble. Yep. Yeah.
Humble. She's a yeah. very, very humble person. And yeah. You're going to see some great work out of her.
That's good. That's good.
When we talk about JR, I've watched you through the years, and
y'all get ready, y'all.
When I talk about, you know, there's so much that you can say that you should have done, mm-hmm. Opportunity that we would say that you could have had, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Based on decisions and things you did.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, right. yeah, yeah, you, yeah, you. Sometimes y'all, JR has a hard time, you know, grasping the bigger picture and listening. But at the end of the day, we're where God wants us to be.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. Definitely.
You know, yeah. We may have done things differently if we had done these things differently.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day,
yeah, yeah,
we are where God wants us to be. Right. And I would just say to you, man, that. Just do what you're doing at this moment. Stay connected, looking for help, always asking those that have been in position and where you are, mm-hmm. what do you do, how do you do? Don't, because there is nothing new under the sun, don't try to create what don't need to be created.
Yeah, yeah, that's good.
But you are where you are supposed to be, because that's where God has us at this moment. Mm-hmm. Who would have mm-hmm. thought that you would be on the brink of mm-hmm. some great things
yeah, yeah.
that we'll just hold we'll on hold to right that. There. Yeah, great things that we are prayerful are going to take place
yeah, yeah.
for your future.
Yeah. Well, listen, it has been an honor, and I say that with all humbleness, to be here at Greater Joy. A lot of people have seen my growth from, man, I've been here probably altogether 10 years maybe. Yeah.
How long you been preaching now?
I did my initial sermon in 2009. Mm-hmm. So I feel like I'm an old head now.
Yeah, you've been preaching a while.
Yeah, so it's been great. And so I just want to thank you for the opportunities, even with eCampus. I just found out the other day we have members in Charlotte.
Wonderful.
In Charlotte. So eCampus is doing well.
Good
and
deal.
So I please report that. And so, listen, it has been an amazing interview with our leader, Bishop Shelton Daniel, to hear from him about the transition. I'm about to let him have final words about the transition or whatever he may want to encourage us with. But let's remember, guys, please register for homecoming September 3rd and 4th. I'm sorry. Please purchase your shirts for homecoming for September 3rd and 4th. Also, let us start preparing now to get acclimated back in church in the month of October, because every Tuesday night, every Wednesday night, we're going to be right here at Greater Joy and Greater Joy Roanoke Rapids as we have guest speakers, guest psalmists coming in, as we celebrate our pastor for his pastor's anniversary throughout the entire month of October. If you have any questions, any concerns, or anything you want to bring to me regarding pastor's anniversary or homecoming, please reach out to me regarding that. And look, I look forward to that. Any last words you would like to share with us, Bishop Daniel?
I'd just like to say thanks to all of the Greater Joy people, especially Greater Joy founders. There were some people that were a part of ministry or are a part of ministry that started with us. And if we hadn't had that band of soldiers that believed in doing something different and great, we wouldn't be here. So you can never forget the founders of the group. I just want to say thanks to them. And then I want to say thanks to all that have hung in there through pandemic and are hanging in there through transition. I'll share this with you and we'll go. And I shared with a group of believers of because one of some of the work that I'm doing is interim work at other churches. And I shared with a group of believers on yesterday, and that is, if the church is going to continue, if the church is going to go forward, parishioners don't have to always agree with the leader, but parishioners do have to follow. They don't have to always agree with decisions, but they do have to follow. If the church is going to go forward, we have to let the leaders lead. That would be my final with the people today. Let people lead.
Wow. So can you give us, lead. We need to follow. That, in, yeah. In other words, we must follow. Bishop, can you close us out in closing prayer?
I will. Eternal God, we are so grateful for this time, this moment, this station, this platform that you've allowed us to reach out to your people. God, we are prayerful that something that Elder JR has asked and something that I have responded to has helped someone to be clearer about future and help someone be more committed and stable with the church. And we just ask that you would be in the midst of all that we do as we move forward, because we realize that, God, without you, we can do nothing, but with you, the sky is the limit. All things are possible. So, God, we just ask that you would be in the midst of all locations, not just Greater Joy, but listeners everywhere, people that may be listening that may not even be a part of Greater Joy. Help us, God, to be better and Christians and more committed Christians and more willing Christians as we move forward and continue your work. If, God, there are those among us that have things that they have not asked God to release them from and forgive them of, do it right now, God. We ask for a spirit of forgiveness, a spirit of releasing, a spirit of moving past our past, and we give your name praise and honor. We just ask that you would be in the midst of all that we do, everything that lies ahead. Everyone listening, God, help them in everything they do, everything that lies ahead of them. And we give you the glory and the praise. We claim it in Jesus' name. And drive a Amen. Fancy car.
Listen, thank you for joining us on your summer playlist. We will have a grand finale. Hopefully we get all can I take you out to dinner, babe? We'll come together real soon. Cause that's but we'll keep it closer to the next that I wanna say episode to you. Summer love is all I
account with seven figures, and I may not have a sailboat and a big old mansion, oh no, but I do know how to love you, baby. And in my own way, in my own way, I'm rich as hell. I really hope that none of this don't matter, and I hope that you don't judge a man
by status. And I was wondering if you and I could get together, know each other better. And I promise you, I'll give my all and make my heart your mansion. I give you all. Tweet, tweet, tweet.